Good afternoon. For those of you who do not know my name or hearing me for the first time, my name is Eklak, which mispronounced like Eklak means 1/10 of a million, and pronounced correctly, which is Eklak, it means good behavior. And friends who know me say there is a 1 in 10 million chance of me having good behavior. I'm a technology guy, but I'm also a neuro-linguistic programming practitioner. That's NLP, but not the natural language processing. Some element of it is in the presentation. In fact, the entire presentation has been designed keeping NLP in mind. And I'm also a life and executive coach. I work with Fullerton India. Today's presentation, though, is not only about Fullerton India, but it is also about Max Life Insurance, which is my previous employer, and about GE, HT Media, or any other enterprise. For all the things that you need to do today, whether it is what Avaya spoke about, or the Dell spoke about security, voice, AI, you need investment. And CIOs today, and have been for some years, have had this challenge of attracting and convincing the CXOs to put more money into technology. But I have a request. By the way, the timer is not 15 minutes. Can you please reset that to 30 minutes? Thank you. Avoid the mobile. There is the Wi-Fi and the 4G here has been infected with the malware. So if you use your mobile, it will get infected. I'm just kidding. But there's another reason I got Bollywood in my presentation. So for the gentlemen here, we got Sunny Leone. And for the ladies here, we got Amir Khan, Salman Khan, Shah Rukh Khan. All the Khans. Alright. Actually, I do have all the Khans, except Steph, though. Someday I'll have that as well. But this is the normal talk about IT budgets. IT budget is a black box. We don't understand where the money is going. We have invested a lot in technology, but we don't know what's happening with that. So you are not going to get more money. But what would it take for CXOs to choose to invest in technology? So here's a question for you. If there is 1 hour left and 20 runs to make, and you got Sehwag and Dravid in your bench, who are you going to send?
Sehwag.
Sehwag, alright. You've just gotten into a follow-on and you got to bat to save the test match. Who are you going to send? Alright. You are making a movie for the family. Right? It's a family movie. Who are you likely to choose? Vidya Balan or Sunny Leone? Anybody for Sunny Leone? Alright, I'll make sure the message reaches us that nobody wants her in a family movie. But if you are making Ragini MMS3, who are you likely to choose? Nobody wants to say Sunny Leone. Alright, okay. There could be a reason. But why are we doing this? Why is it that when I spoke about 1 over 20 runs, people said Sehwag, saving the innings, Dravid, family movie, Vidya Balan? Why is that? Anybody wants to take a guess? Why do we choose these names for these particular issues and problems?
Proven success.
Proven success. What are the reason?
Past experience and...
Yes, past experience.
Best fit in the situation.
Sorry?
Best fit in the situation.
Best fit in the situation. True.
Their domain expertise.
Domain expertise. Alright.
Acceptability.
Acceptability. Does reputation play a role?
A lot.
Yeah. It's about reputation. So everything that you guys said is true. And together, when you put it together, expertise, domain expertise, past experience, all of that combines to become what you call a reputation. And the simple formula, though, although it's simple, it's a difficult one to do. Your investment in technology is directly proportional to the reputation of technology in that company. And you could be a technology team that is known to be a technology team, or you could be a technology team that is trusted. Yeah. But you will continuously get more and more investment, and whatever investment you require in technology, if it is there is credibility for the technology team. So my presentation is about 5 tips that I'm going to share with you as to how to build a reputation and credibility so that whenever you go ask for investment, you get the investment that you need. Anybody wants to guess why I've put in these hands for counting and not anything else? There are many other pictures I could have used, but why choosing to indicate numbers by palm of the hand? Any guesses? Sorry?
I don't know.
It'll look like mudras. Alright, that's an interesting guess. Well, sorry? Collectiveness, isolation, collectiveness. Okay, yeah, that's usually one of the reasons that people come up with. But the real thing is, you got to do what is in your control and what is in your hands. So therefore, my presentation is not going to talk about change the organization culture. You can't, that's outside of your hand. My presentation is not going to talk about change the CEO or turn around the CFO, because these are outside your control and outside of your hand. But we're going to talk about things that are definitely in your control. So let me start with the first one. Filmen sirf teen wajah se chalti hai, entertainment, entertainment, entertainment. What is also true, IT runs because of only 3 reasons: business, business, business. I say that because we are all working for enterprises. We are not an IT company. If I was Infosys, TCS, Dell, I could understand. Even there, sales, distribution, customer service, these are the frontline businesses or frontline for the company. Technology supports these business outcomes. And therefore, when you're asking for investment in tech, you got to talk about business. This is the way we asked for investment in Fullerton as well as in MaxLife. First, talk about the project, but you got to say what the project is going to do for the business. There are 5 reasons why you would invest in technology, either to enable revenue, or to reduce cost, or to improve experience, increase compliance, or reduce risk. If you're doing a project that does not hit at least one of these, the project is not worth doing. Simple. And every investment that you ask for, you got to say what it's got to do for that business. And this is a, notice that in this slide, there are 60-70% of the space goes talking about business, and only a very small amount of space goes about talking about what is the investment that you require. So keep talking business. Here's another way. Whenever we ask where is the IT budget going, we come back with saying 20% goes into our ERP system, SAP or Oracle, 10% goes into CRM, 5% goes here, so many crores into system X or system Y. Here's another way to look at it. Divide your IT budget into business processes. Every system serves a business process. CRM serves lead management, your sales system serves sales, your ERP serves a business process. Put that money back into that business process and say, this is where the money is going. You take the discussion away from money going into Oracle, SAP, CRM, Salesforce, and you change the conversation to the money is going into product development, money is going into sales, money is going into customer servicing, and that's truly where the money is going. The business doesn't see it that way, because we present it as hardware, software, but in reality, you're investing all of that money into serving a business purpose. So why not show that as a business purpose? Well, this is a slide from early 2017 when we were seeking investment in AI bots and RPA. You would notice that in this entire slide, around 2% is technology, which is those 3 words: RPA, bots, and AI. The rest of it is business. So we said that this is what the world is doing with these technologies, and then this is what Max Life Insurance can do with that technology. So it's not so much about technology, it's what you can do with that technology, and that's true across all these 3 technologies. Again, notice on this slide, 95% of it is about business. So when you put technology before business, that's the cart before the horse. When you put business before technology, that's the right way to do it. The horse before the cart. Okay, the next one. Even when you talk about business, some people have strong opinions about IT. Even when you keep talking business, so what do you do there? I have another dialogue. Mere paas emotion hai, drama hai, gussa hai. You know the frustration that users express with IT. Project late ho gaya, PC nahi milta, keyboard nahi milta, email nahi milta. What do you have? Mere paas data hai. All right. And this is not business data. You usually think about data as business data. I suggest and I urge you, encourage you to get data on technology, on your own function. And I will show you some of the things that we did at Max Life Insurance and we're doing at Fullerton. When I joined Max Life, we were told business does not trust IT. So I said, okay, we got to improve the trust between business and IT. You can't improve something that you can't measure. So we embarked on a very interesting journey with the team. We said, how are you going to measure trust? So we chose Google. We came up with this definition of trust. Well, how do you measure credibility, reliability, intimacy, also divided by self-orientation? But we did create something called trust meter. I will show you how that works. The business trusts IT on fundamentally two categories. One, how are you doing on your projects? Okay, are you delivering them on time? Are you delivering them to scope? Is the quality good and is it within budget? That's what business cares about. So whenever you deliver something on time, you get some points. You deliver before time, a lot of points, but if you delay, you get negative points. The same thing with quality, the same thing with scope. The other category that business cares about is how stable, secure, reliable and fast your systems are. So if you go by a month with 0 hours of downtime, you get certain points. But if you have a few hours of downtime, you get negative points. And it leans a lot towards being harsh. So if you get plus 10 points for something, you could get minus 50 for the opposite. Because that's how trust works. If I were to tell you, you do one good thing, perhaps you will get one pat on the back. But if you do one wrong thing, there will be 99 people critiquing you. And that's how trust works. So we created this trust meter. It went up and down. There were times we moved data center. It was a two-day affair. But then the entire company was down for 1.5 days after the data center move. So the trust meter lost a lot of points. We implemented a system called Uno. It was delayed by a year. We lost a lot of points. But then there were a few things that we did right. And we gained a lot of points there. And this has been the case for 3 years now. We started at 5,000 and I believe that now it is at 17,000, the last time we checked. And if you think I'm making this up, look at this. This is a real picture of a 12 by 8 feet boat that is right outside the office. And every time we go live with a project, we make a new bet and put it in that hole so that the entire team views how we are doing on our trust meter. This is almost like our stock. How is the IT stock doing within the company? We were told that IT is not doing enough projects and therefore IT must develop bandwidth to be able to do more projects. And I knew that we were working on a lot of projects, but it was just sentiment, subjective. IT was saying we were working on a lot of projects and business was saying no, you got to do more. This is what we did. We measured the number of projects we were doing was 65. We gathered data on the number of person days of development in these 65 projects. It was total 23,000 person days of development. And according to Gartner, for every person day of development, for every 100% day of development, you need 15% days of project management, because I don't have developers on my team, I have people who manage the enterprises. So with that we came to a certain number, and it says the number of employees required to be able to manage so many projects with so many percentage of development is 162, but we only have 54 people managing these projects, And therefore, every employee in IT is overworked 2.76 times. When we shared this data for the first time, of course, the reaction from the leadership team was, get out of here. But then we stood the ground, we said, this is data. You can go, you can ask your teams to go back, verify data, this is from Gartner, we have done the homework, this is true. I knew that my team was overworked, so there was a need to actually bring down the projects, not do more projects. And this was one of the things that, by the way, we did this by function, so we know there were certain functions IT was more overworked than in others, but on an average 2.76 times. So when you got data, I can speak a lot on this, but when you got data on IT, it will eat opinion for breakfast. All right, what's next? Even if you get data, business will push you even more, that's true. Then the Bazinger dialogue comes in. Kabhi kabhi, jeetne ke liye, haarna bhi padta hai. Aur haar ke jeetne wale ko, Bazinger kehte hai. Excuse me, my next recommendation is, be your biggest critic. Before the business criticizes, criticize yourself, so the business does not have an opportunity to do so. We did a survey on IT in 2015. It came out pretty bad. This is top two box score. That means people who gave, percentage of people who gave 4 and 5 on a 1 to 5 scale. And it was 18%, 28%, 37%. But the data at the help desk showed 85%. You know the one that you measure, sir, aapka ticket kitse resolve hua hai ki nahi, are you happy? Press 1, press 2. That was showing as green. The end user survey showed red. But we shared that with the manager and said, okay, we're going to work on getting better from here. And of course, in 2017, it was much better, and we measured it in 2018. It was even better, it was closer to 75%, so on and so forth. So it's okay if things are wrong in IT, because things are not perfect anywhere. And it's okay to share that with the business and say that, look, I know what is wrong with my team or with my department, and I'm going to work on it and I'm going to fix it. That would lend more credibility than saying everything is good, right? Here's another one, it always works. Whenever I start a presentation to the business, I start with the voice of the business and I capture the sentiment. There's a difference between acknowledging and agreeing. Acknowledgement is, okay, I heard you. Agreeing is, I agree to what I heard you. This is about acknowledging. Say that I heard you. I hear that the sentiment is we are doing too little, we are not delivering projects on time. I hear that there are a lot of IT issues, we can do more. It's about acknowledging. And when the business sees that you have acknowledged and you have heard them, their resistance does not disappear, it comes down, and it comes down significantly. There's another one in February 2017. We need to be more stable, we need more security, execute projects quickly, be the benchmark, collaborate, and co-create. And here another one, Max Life did not have an innovation initiative, so we decided to run an innovation initiative of our own. But innovation, as you know, ladies and gentlemen, it is about experiments. You run 10 experiments, 2 would be successful, those would be innovation. But then, number of experiments that you run is inversely proportional to the cost of the experiment. If the business comes to you and says, I have this idea, and you say it's going to take 1 crore and 6 months, the business is going to shy away from trying that out. But if you say it's going to cost you 5 lakhs and you can do it in 1 month or 2 months, you would run a lot of experiments. So we partnered with a lot of startups, medium enterprises, and we did a lot of POCs for free, but we ran it under a program called Sparkle. And in fact, IT took the lead in doing some of these. We said if the POC is successful, we'll get a business champion. Once you get a business champion, we'll scale it up. But we ran several of these small projects at free, or at 5 lakhs, or at 1 lakh or 2 lakh, which was much easier. When you don't critique yourself, when you say you're the best, the business will find a way to wake you up. But when you critique yourself and you're self-driven, that's how the business views you. Alright. Let's go next. Being self-driven is a good thing, but you can't do everything right. That is true. Can you do everything right? Look. Like this dialogue. एक बार तो मैंने कमिटमेंट कर दी फिर मैं अपने आप की भी नहीं सुनता. The next suggestion is deliver on critical projects. If you are working on 100 projects, rest assured there are 5 that are critical, the other 95 are important, not as critical as these 5. What I mean to say is, if you deliver on those 95 projects, but you miss on these critical 5 projects, you will not get the points. Right? But if you deliver on this 5 and you miss on some of those 95, you're going to relatively get higher points than if you were to miss. So find out, know that these are the projects that are really, really important to the business. And make sure you put your resources behind and delivering those. For example, digital transformation was one of those projects that is really important for the business. We knew that and we delivered on that. I'm not going to talk about it. Just know that these projects constituted nearly 10% of our total project base. Out of the 65 projects that I spoke about, around 6 projects were on digital transformation. There's another one I met with the CFO in my induction meeting. He said, Iqlaq, I needed to save 20 crores of project cost over 3 years. And he kept repeating that in my induction meeting, you know, the first meeting with the CFO, 4 or 5 times, I understood it's important. The IT cost in the IT budget in absolute term went up, but on the base we saved 20 crores over 3 years because I knew this was really, really important for the CFO. So we delivered on this and we got a lot of accolades for this, and of course the IT cost ratio to as a percentage of OPEX or a percentage of revenue kept coming down. And this is counterintuitive to the presentation, how to attract more investment in technology. But again, the IT cost is going down. When the business scales, your IT cost does not scale in the same proportion. And if that happens, change the business. Because the business is not scaling well enough. when you deliver on critical projects, the business thinks of you as an expressway. Otherwise, we are a cobbled row. Okay, let's go next. And this is the last. I would say one of my favorite sections because it's the softer side of what we do. What is this a definition of? Anybody wants to take a guess?
Machine.
Gear. Okay, that's a good guess. Anybody else?
Machine.
Machine, who said machine? Yeah, very good. If I had a prize, I'll give it to you. Because that's the definition of machine when you search Google. Right? And is another one. Remember 3 idiots? What is the definition of machine? Anything that reduces human effort. It's a much simpler definition. And yet when we talk technology to the business, we use complicated terms. I like to use this analogy. You know, there are far fewer plane crashes than there are car accidents, right? The ratio of plane crashes to car crashes is going to be much a fraction. But yet, there are more people afraid of going on a flight than getting into a car. Why do you think that is?
Because of media coverage.
Because of the media coverage? No. Why are people more afraid of a plane than into a car when cars crash more often statistically than planes?
You can't avoid getting into a car.
You can't avoid getting into the car. Well, I'll give you, for paucity of time, 2 reasons. One, the risk is very high, right? You are up in the mid-air, something happens, it's life and death. In a car crash, you can survive, you can escape with some injury. So the risk is very high. But the more important reason, most important reason is, when you walk into that plane, that cockpit door is closed. And your life is in somebody's hand. And when the cockpit door is open, you see that panel, it's so complicated, it scares you. Right? That's how business thinks about IT. They know that not having IT is a huge risk, but it is not in their hands, it is in their CTO's hand. And when the CTO shows me technology, it is so complicated. So they are more afraid of approaching IT, and therefore they're trying to put IT. So simplify IT. This is our explain cloud. Bare metal servers, buy a piece of land, build a single story house. This is the bare metal servers. Virtual servers, buy a piece of land, buy a multi-story house. Then cloud, buy a piece of land, build an apartment complex with a swimming pool, with a clubhouse, with shared resources. And we know that to house large populations, apartment complexes work much better than single story houses. And therefore, that's how cloud has become popular, just like apartment complexes have become popular in the urban areas. This is how I explain machine learning. All of you know this story, right? What has this got to do with machine learning? Right? The crow is the machine, actually. You see, machine learning, what happens is, you got some training data, and you put some input, you get an output. That is the actual output, and there's a desired output that you want, right? The distance between the actual output and the desired output is the distance between the crow's beak and the level of water. Think of pebbles as training data. The more pebbles and the more training data you give to the machine, the better the algorithm becomes, and the actual output starts to come closer to the desired output. And that's how, ladies and gentlemen, machine learning works, and that's all the business needs to know. You don't need to explain neural networks. You don't need to explain random forest algorithms. You don't need to explain the complications behind artificial intelligence. You just got to say, instead of coding, the machine gets trained on the logic. This is the NLP bit, neural linguistic programming. Neural is how the human mind works. Linguistic is how language affects us and others, and programming is how you can use language to influence self and others. So here are 5 tips. Replace the word but with the word and. Oh, what is the CTO talking about? Think about it for a minute. When you are in interaction, especially if you are performance review, your manager goes, "Hey Clark, you have done a great job. You have delivered on 65 projects. You know, you come to office on time and you leave early. But, you know, there was this one project that you did not do well on." And you are waiting for that but to come, right? When somebody is speaking, you know there is a but coming somewhere. And the moment the but comes, you focus your attention on everything that comes after the but. That's what happens. When you use the word but, the listener will forget everything before the but. Right? And you just change it to and. Then you're giving importance to what you have said before and what you're going to say after. Do that with the business, it works. There's another one. Replace the word if with a word called when. If I could CEO, if I could get time on your calendar versus CEO, when I get time in your calendar. When you use the word when, you're saying there's no doubt in my mind of that you're going to give me time. But when you say if, then you're giving somebody the option to say no. When it is only about when, it's not a question of if, it's only a question of when. This is my favorite, and I challenge you. It's a challenge, just think about it. For everything you can't do, there is something you can do. Intuitively, it doesn't come. I've had several arguments with my team and my colleagues and my friends. There are some places where you have to use the word can. And I have argued always that there is always a can. The business says, if you say, I can't do this project live in 1 month, you can say, I can do this project in 3 months. Always use the word can, because that will what will make you a can do person. But if you keep using the word can't, because the business pushes you so much, you'll start to become a can't do person. And when you think about it, there is always a can for a can. I'm not going to explain more, but there are 2 other words, hope and try, that can be replaced with will and do. I know this is a difficult one to grasp, because it does not usually come in technology presentations. And its impact, isse kya hoga yaar, ye word ko replace karne se kya hoga? I would urge you to just read the top line as a phrase and the bottom line as a phrase. But, if, can't, hope, try as a phrase. Compare that to and, when, can, will, not. The difference between these 2 phrases. That's how words matter. use imagery to convey concepts. I'm just going to take 3 minutes more, maybe two, maybe even 2 minutes. When I was told IT needs to do more projects, I put three images and I asked the business, how do you think IT works in our company? Does it work this way? Does it work this way? Or does it work this way? Okay, let me show that to you. Does it work this way, this way, or this way? What do you think the answer was? Almost all of them chose this. And then we showed the data of the 65 projects and the IT being overworked. And we said, what, instead of doing more projects, we just need to become sharper about how we do projects. But then use imagery. I'm not going to talk about the video too little time. Just to summarize, right? I spoke about investment in technology. When you go asking for investment, yes, this is always a good business plan for what you're asking for, right? But it is your reputation that matters the most on whether or not you get that investment. Now, how do you build that reputation? Always talk business first. Have data on your own function. Be your biggest critic, be self-driven, deliver on critical projects, and simplify IT and communicate effectively. I'm going to end with this. This is a picture of Kumkar and Wadh. Okay, the reason I use this is to say three things. First, size does not matter. You know, we think, you know, because the business thinks IT is back office, you know, what can we do? Size does not matter. And whether it is Satyug or Kalyug, and whether it is God or human beings, as you notice, tools and technologies are always needed to win a war or win a battle. And therefore, we must continue to invest more and more in technology. Thank you.